You know, I felt like another round was only appropriate. Hi guys, how you doing? Nick Jennison, Guitar Interactive, GI Plus. Happy New Year. It's not Monday, it's Wednesday. We're still on the hangover from the festive period where our week has been thoroughly disrupted. So we are doing the stream 2 days late. Otherwise, we would have been doing it on New Year's Day, which I'm sure wouldn't have been popular. Certainly not in my household, let's put it that way. So anyway, not popular with my band either, because we would have had to cancel a gig. And New Year's gigs are big earners. So waffling aside, hey, thanks for coming. Welcome on board. This is the first stream of a whole new year. We are embarking on a whole voyage of streams this year where we're going to be continuing with this whole educational process. I have absolutely loved building this little community with you guys over the last 2 years, and we're going to continue in exactly the same vein in this year. I'm looking forward to doing some really, really cool stuff with you. Today, we are discussing the topic of, it says so in the title down here, which I assume is down here. If you're watching on YouTube, it's probably somewhere over here. The topic of New Year, New Licks. Because we always do this New Year, New Me thing, so why not have some new licks in the process? But first of all, want to take this opportunity, if you're a new streamer, new member of our streaming community, if this is the first time watching, or however many times you've been watching, I want to welcome you on board. It is everyone's first time watching in 2024. So yeah, welcome on board. We normally do this on Mondays. It says Monday down here, 8 p.m. UK time. We are back to Mondays, back to our regular time slot as of next week. So our next stream will be the coming Monday, which, if I check my calendar real quick, will be Monday the 8th. So mark your diaries, Monday the 8th, we are back to our Monday streams from then on. So this is our last Wednesday stream, but we're back to Mondays. But yeah, welcome aboard. It's lovely to have you. We do these every Monday. We hang out, we talk about the guitar, we talk about different guitar topics, we try and learn something. Hopefully there's a little something for every guitar player in this. Certainly guitar players of every level. That's kind of what we're aiming for. So don't be perturbed by all of the notes in the intro if you're sat going, wow, is this a stream for shredders? It can be, but it's not only a stream for shredders, let's say. So anyway, want to take a second and say a quick hello to the guys in the stream. We've got some new friends, we've got some old friends. Most of our existing community is here. There are a few notable absences, but hey, it's this weird period in time between Christmas. Well, it's not even between Christmas and New Year, it's after New Year, and the world hasn't really properly restarted yet. We're getting there, but I figure next Monday, the rest of the world will be back to normal. Myself, I've been beavering away in my studio most of the festive period, but let me know what you guys have been up to. Let me know what you got up to on New Year in particular. If you were playing guitar in New Year, let me know what you were playing. Let me know how it went. Were you playing in a band? Did you have a gig? Did you play at a party? Let me know. I'd love to hear from you. So first of all, I want to say hello to our friend Chris Brown. Chris is a fabulous guitar player who regularly tags me and stuff on Instagram. I love to see it, right? Absolutely love to see it. There was a clip recently where he was playing live using a Marshall jackhammer. And that kind of stuck with me because that was one of the first distortion pedals I ever have. I had the much maligned Marshall Governor 2, which is the little silver Governor, which didn't sound a whole lot like the original Governor. But for whatever reason, with the rig I was using at the time, it just sounded really, really sweet and had loads of juice in it. It was a bit thuddy, but I had kind of a thin sounding amp, so it sort of balanced out. But yeah, jackhammer, really underrated overdrive pedal and some fantastic playing. So Chris is saying, hi guys, happy new year. My creativity started to really open up when I started to listen to and transcribe sax players, especially Paul Desmond for the Dave Brubeck Quartet. The way horn players structure their melodic phrases are so unlike typical blues-based guitar licks, and I now like to combine traditional guitar language with different melodic choices of jazzers. Nail on the head, man. This is one of those moments where guitar players start to, I guess it's kind of a moment in a guitar player's growth. We start to explore the way other instruments phrase. So for me, I took a lot of phrasing inspiration from the way drummers play fills, particularly, I'm gonna call it gospel chops, even though that's potentially litigious. There's a history about that, but particularly the way gospel drummers tend to play. I don't listen to a lot of gospel music, but I love those drummers that were coming up in the kind of early 2010s who were playing that crazy, crazy stuff where I felt like there was a rhythmic phrase space throughout a bar. So maybe the phrase might be something like bop, 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 bop. something like that. But it didn't really have discrete subdivisions within. It was just blurs of notes with accents marking out a rhythmic phrase. And that really inspired me. Similarly, got a lot of inspiration from the way prog keyboard players will play. Specifically, there's a Jordan Rudess type thing. It's not the flashy stuff, funnily enough. It's the pitch bend stuff that they'll do. Took a lot of inspiration from that. So anyway, we'll waffle about that another time, maybe taking inspiration from other instruments. But that's very, very cool. Another place you might look is great vocalists. You know, great singers. Take a listen to the way they phrase. It can really inject some lovely stuff in your playing, but horn players, huge deal. I happen to be lucky enough to share a wall with in the studio complex that we're in with a sax player called Alex, who's absolutely fabulous. And I listen to his licks coming through the wall, and I'm like, man, I want to steal some of that. So one of these days, I'm going to go and plant a camera in his studio and see what it is that he's playing. And I still probably won't be able to figure it out because he's great. But anyway, really, really cool stuff. Love to hear it. Who else in the house? Timothy Appling has joined us. Timothy, it's great to have you on board. Response Audio is here. Hey, Marcine. I'm not seeing Marcine's comment here. So unless we're just assuming Marcine is here, which would make sense. But if Marcine, if you're here, drop us a comment, say hello. Love to hear from you. Marcine is always first, but I don't see his comment today and I don't know why. Happy New Year. Yes, Christopher, horn players will definitely open up your phrasing for sure. Hey Timothy, happy new year. Totally agree. Yeah, Timothy and Response Audio and Chris Brown, anybody else who happens to be watching, happy new year. Daryl Queens is happy new year. Hope the new year is kicking off well for everyone. Sure is. Been soldering all day today. Got my soldering iron right here. Doing some guitar mods. Not this guitar, but a bunch of other guitars. Been playing around with that stuff. I think I'm tempted to install Varitone in this guitar, but we'll talk about that another time. Who else do we have? Sacred Godslayer is here. Love to have you on board, our Italian metal correspondent. Some great comments from Daryl Queen. Says, hey, Christopher, agreed on transcribing horn players, keys players, and even vocalists. Great minds, what can we say? Like Response Audio says, it helps so much with phrasing and breaking out of the guitar cliches. I'm going to star these up because we're going to come back to these comments. But if you have any questions about this stuff, drop them down below because we'll hit those up when we get to the Q&A session because there's some really good stuff here. Daryl Queens, does anyone play any big gigs on New Year's Eve? I didn't. I had New Year's Eve off this year, which was unusual for me, but I'm happy about it. Did a pub up in the country near me on New Year's Day. It was lovely. Nice little small pub. Nice to play somewhere like that. It's very cool. Who else do we have in the house? Let's get some old or new friends in. We'll see what's going on here. We've got some lovely comments. Kind of highlight those as we go forward, but let's just quickly rattle through these. So Mark Crandall is in the house, says, happy new year, Nick and fellow guitarist. Happy new year to you too, Mark. Missed out on last week due to self-isolating with COVID. Oh no, man, I hope you're feeling better. It is no joke, right? It's not fun. My partner had it recently. She really suffered with it. I did the two times I've had it. It really didn't feel great. Wasn't much fun at all, so I hear you. Who else? We've got a lot of love for Steely Dan in the comments as well. We do love a bit of Steely Dan here. They've had so many great guitar players come through, which is crazy. Mark Crandall's seen Steely Dan more than 30 or more years ago. Absolutely wild. But yeah, man, for sure. We've got some great theory comments coming here. I love to see this sort of stuff. So I've kind of skipped over some of this stuff, but we're talking about viewing chords like D major 7 as a rootless B minor 9. Love this sort of stuff, right? This is kind of what we're talking about. It's great to see you guys discussing these concepts in the comments. We do love a bit of that. So we'll come back to that as we go forward. Foghornish is in the house. Great to see you. Larry Warren is here. Been checking out Larry Warren's Christmas album. It's a bit late now, but this time next year. Hey, who else do we have? Steve McDee is here. Lovely to see you. David Peterson says, sweet intro. Thanks, man. Appreciate it. Saying the Daryl Queen saying the backing track is giving Rolling Stones or Black Crowes. For sure. That's the two bands that I had in mind when I put that track together. I'm a fan of both. So I'm like, hey, wouldn't it be fun to do something that kind of, combines the two. Also, the track is available on the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel. So, lovely comment from Mark McNish is saying, hello all, hey Nick, I've been focused on minimizing my fretting hand pressure and optimizing my picking. Seems I'm picking up speed. That's a great sign, man. Now, the thing with this is we do tend to fall into these habits of overplaying, let's say. And I don't mean overplaying the way that I tend to overplay, which is playing too many notes. I mean overplaying in terms of putting too much energy into the guitar, expecting more to come out, but it's not always the way it works. So really pleased to hear you getting results with that. That's really, really cool. Who else do we have? Sacred Godslayer says, I spent the first of the year battling with the guitar, changing saddles on the telly, putting flat wounds on a Starcaster. That's an interesting choice. And trying to fix a guitar I purchased that arrived in bad shape. I want to know what this guitar is. Because I'm curious. That's basically it. Oh yeah, if anybody got new guitars over the Christmas period or any new gear, let us know. We'd love to hear from you. We got a comment about Alan Holdsworth, for sure. Alan Holdsworth is here, saying, Mark Crandall says regarding Alan Holdsworth. Alan Holdsworth tried to play guitar like a horn player. For sure, apparently he didn't want to be a guitar player. Apparently he wanted to be a horn player, but his parents couldn't afford a saxophone, so they got him a guitar. I can understand. Saxophones are expensive. For sure, you know, Alex keeps telling me. Anyway, who else do we have? Marcin is here. I don't know why I didn't get those comments earlier on, man. It's a bizarre one, but it's lovely to have you. I didn't feel a disturbance in the force, so I assumed that you were here. Who else do we have? Have you fixed the Ibanez neck? I have not fixed the Ibanez neck, but it's not really the neck that's the problem, to be honest. It's the electronics, but fear not. Soldering iron, the hot stick is in hand. Fear not, also, it's not hot right now. It has been hot earlier on today, but it's not hot right now. Jackson Broderick Pro Series, I'm guessing, is the one that arrived in bad shape. That's a cool guitar, man. Chris Broderick is just one of those guitar players. Like, it's a funny one. I feel like people don't... I don't see as much love for Chris Broderick as I thought I would. Because, I mean, guy is... just tremendous, absolutely wonderful player. This eight finger thing blows my mind every time I see it. His guitars are very cool. Transparent is in the house. Lovely to see you lurking from Denmark. A blizzard raging outside at the minute. I am sorry to hear that, but hey man, you know, Denmark's a lovely place. We do like a bit of Denmark. Our label is originally from Denmark. Anyway, so we could talk about this all day. Ooh, Steve McDee got a Fender Ultra Telecaster for Christmas. That's a cool guitar. We like them. Very, very cool indeed. We could waffle about this stuff all day. Keep dropping them in. Keep dropping your comments down below. Love to hear from you. We'll say some more hellos as we get further on, but I want to get into the meat of today's session, which is the concept of new year, new licks. You will also notice that the chimp is back, by the way. His name, in case you were wondering, is Princeton the Vibro Chimp. He is our mascot for the streams. Yngwie Malmsteen has gone away for another year. He'll be back at Christmas next year, or this year rather. Anyway, so this concept of new me, new licks, it's a bit of a pun. It's not really a case of like, oh hey, you know, it's the new year, you must learn some new licks, but I can't resist a pun, and I thought it'd be a good time to talk about generating some new musical material with I guess more logical processes rather than just like searching for new material, if that makes sense. So let's get into the meat of it, and we'll talk about what I'm talking about here. So what we're going to do is we're going to begin by exploring some tried and true licks, some licks that we play all of the time. It's interesting that you guys are talking about like kind of transcribing sax players and transcribing vocalists and keyboard players. That's a very cool way to get new licks. And it's also interesting that that's touched on the idea of these kind of like guitarisms that we play all the time. I'm going to show you a few that I'm talking about. We're playing in C today. So if we go to the two close-up cams real quick, our C minor pentatonic, which is where we might begin, because let's be honest, we all tend to go straight to C minor pentatonic if we don't know where we are. I've even seen Steve Vai do this a lot, so don't worry, you're not a bad guitar player for doing this. The best in the world do this too. So it's a really weird one. I often see Steve go straight to this shape there. That neck pickup is sounding really, really sweet today. But yeah, it's I've seen Steve go to that shape a whole lot, so fear not, it's quite common. Anyway, we're going to start with some licks that are, I guess, quite tried and true. We're going to throw our Black Crow style backing track back on. I'm going to knock my monitors down just a little bit so I don't feel like I have to shout over the top. And what we might do is we might start by taking a look at a lick that goes like this, which is about as guitar-tastic as it gets. Now, if you haven't played this lick before, it can mean one of two things. It can mean that you're quite new to the guitar, and that means you're about to learn a cool lick, which is good. Or it can mean that maybe you don't have a grounding in the blues, that's also fine. It means we're going to learn some blues today. So what we might do is we might start with this 8th position minor pentatonic, which is going to give us 11-8, 11-8, 10-8, 10-8, 10-8, 11-8 down at the bottom. We're going to begin on the G string, and we're going to start by bending the G string 8th fret, oh, sorry, 10th fret rather, up to the pitch of 12. Easy enough, right? This is also a good test to see if you guys are bending in tune. Bearing in mind that this note sounds in tune, it is fractionally flat. Actually, in tune is here. The sound is nice. Fractionally flat sounds a little better. We'll talk about that in a minute. Remind me, we talked about Paul Rogers, but we'll get to that. So anyway, we have this. We're going to follow it 8 and 8 on the B string, high E string. So we get this. Let's go again. One more time. Last time. Now, let's finish that up with 8 on the B string, 11 on the B string, and then a bend up to the pitch of 13. So now we get this. Very guitar-y leg. Let's just practice a few more times to make sure we've got it under our fingers. Now, there's absolutely not a single thing wrong with that lick. That lick sounds really, really cool. And I'm going to take a second and invoke Guthrie Govan once again, because you guys know I'm a big Guthrie fan. We're going to invoke Guthrie here, and the line that he came out with that stuck with me, which is, do remember that nothing ever became a cliche, by being bad. Things only become cliches because they're a bit too good. Right, it's so good that everyone plays them, and then it becomes cliche. Things that are bad don't become cliche, right? They may enter the public consciousness. I'm not saying that everything that's cliche is good, but let's just bear in mind that, you know, things generally don't become cliche because people don't like them. They become cliche because people do like them a little bit too much. What I've found is that sometimes it's important to lie back on cliches and land back on cliches when you're playing and you get a little bit too out there, especially depending on the audience. So for me, if I'm playing for a non-guitar playing audience, which is a lot of the time, if I end up kind of off the rails a bit and we end up doing some crazy stuff, which we might appreciate because, you know, you and I and our friends in the stream, we're all informed guitar players. And if I end up playing stuff like this, I'm exaggerating some comic effects. When I start playing that stuff, you can feel an audience respond. You can feel them start to go, oh yeah, that sounds like the guitar now. What that thing you were doing before was cool, but now it sounds like the guitar. This is also really useful if you find yourself in a situation where you're recording, as you're Back to the Future's helmet strap for sure, right? Yeah, like, you know, your kids are gonna love it. But yeah, it's another useful thing when you find yourself in a situation where maybe you're playing with a band that you don't know terribly well, or you're working with a producer, let's say. You'll see, working with a producer, or you've been called in to play some guitar, and the order of the day is to play a guitar solo. Play some solo guitar. Oftentimes, if it's not a setting where there is commonly out there type guitar stuff, you know, it's often better to lean on these cliches, right? To lean on these kind of cliche ideas, because that's kind of what people are maybe wanting. I've had this a few times when I've done sessions and I've sent off something that I thought was genius. And, you know, they've kind of come back to me and gone, that's not really the vibe we're looking for. Can you make it like maybe a bit more like kind of classic rock or like whatever? Maybe a bit more Jimmy Page or something. And I'm like, yeah, I know what you want. You want the cliche, right? But we're going to assume that we have the cliche. But let's remember that we're not going to throw this out entirely, right? We're not going to completely abandon it in the favor of serialism or something like that. Anyway, like 16-tone even temperament or whatever. But anyway, We're going to take a lick. I'm going to show you a few ways that you can take this lick and you can cycle it in ways that are going to make it a little more interesting, maybe make it a bit more, just have a little bit of a ear catch about it. And the most obvious way to do it, especially if we're taking pentatonic licks, but this applies to a lot of licks too, is just to play the lick in a different position. And what I mean by this is to maintain the same contour that we're playing. This same contour would be something like this. I'll show you it with both hands real quick. So it might look something like this. And you can envisage that lick as going like buh, 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 buh. It has a certain shape to it. Now you could sing this, you could sing it quite comfortably, even if you didn't get the notes right. If you just went, huh, buh, 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 buh. It's not the right notes. It's not even notes particularly, but you can hear that it has the right shape. It's a little bit like the lick that we're trying to play here. Now, you'll hear this when you hear like non-musicians try and ask you to play a song or sing a song. They'll go, oh, we do that song that goes, ba 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 ba. And if they get the rhythm and the contour right, you can usually kind of get what they're on about. Case in point, let me demonstrate this to you. This is the importance of contour. If I play... Oh, I'm low to do that one. If I do like this, let's go. Now that was pleasant, took a while, but it was pleasant. You might not have recognized what that was. You might have gone, just sounds like some nice notes. Maybe sounds a bit like Steve Stevens. Observe. Happy birthday. Genuinely, I was going to do Jingle Bells, but I'm like, no, Christmas is over. It's so funny how we recognize rhythm and contour way more readily than we recognize individual notes. But the point with this is that we can use that to our advantage and we can get the same kind of feel, but with a different kind of flavor by respecting the contour, but just putting it in a different place, putting the actual notes in different places. So if our previous lick was, let's do the Star Wars wipe, was this. What if instead of playing it in this position, we just bumped it down a position to this. This is fifth position of the C minor pentatonic scale. So what we might get here is we might get something that would give us 8 and 6, 8 and 6, 8 and 5, 8 and 5, 8 and 6, 8 and 6. We really only need the top three strings. So we've got 8, 6, 8, 6, 8, 5. Now, if we were to take the same contour, the same idea of bending the highest note on the G string, and then barring the lowest note on the B string and E string, play the low note on the B string, and then bend the highest note in the B string, we could take the lick that was this and turn it into this, which immediately leads me to there. Now, if you followed our previous streams, you know what we're talking about there, but let me show you that in context. So, that's the same as the previous, says transparent. It kind of is. But the difference is the absolute note values. So check and listen to this, right? So if I play, that's the first lick we played. Let's do it again. That's an interesting line. That's one that we haven't maybe heard quite as many times. Now it is, in terms of contour and shape, exactly the same as this. But that sounds pretty cool. I think it sounds like a lot of fun. What if we did the same thing with our major pentatonic? And then here. What if we go back to minor? And what if we do it here in our next position? That's hard. Lots of fun. Now these licks don't sound, they don't sound too different. This is the important bit, right? From our friend Transparent, this is very nice. I agree. I think it's a nice way to do things. They don't sound or feel terribly different to the lick that we're playing, but they're different enough that it starts to have, it starts to lead us in different directions, let's say. So if we then take this, some of the ideas that we've talked about in our previous streams, like, say, colouring in our pentatonic scale with chromatics, which is something that we can start to do where maybe, let's go to these cameras real quick, where maybe we might do something like this. Maybe there. Where instead of just going straight from here to here, we just play every note in between. Well, we can get some different flavors if we start to do like this. Now that just gives us our blues scale, but it still sounds really cool. If I go to the next position, now, don't be afraid to do this with all of your pentatonic licks. Any pentatonic lick that you can play in one position, you can figure out how to play it in the next position, right? And it's gonna give you a similar sound. It's not radically different, but it's gonna give you something familiar, but with a new flavor, a new take on it. So for example, if I... That's a very familiar one. There it is, next position. There's another one, close. Just all sorts of different pentatonic places that we can play this. Marcine has a question, says, you have that pickguard etched, am I correct, looks killer. Thanks, man. Indeed I do. This came factory like this, right? This is an etched pickguard on the Maybach Convair 59 aged that needs a clean, because look at all this stuff, all this gig gunk on it. I'm also showing you the back as well. Check it out. So not just etched pickguards, but also etched back plates. And the reason the truss rod cover is off is because, A, I was setting it up today. It's time for its winder adjustment. But also, I'm hoping to get hold of a similarly etched truss rod cover to go up the top, just to complete the set. Because why wouldn't you? Why would you have one plastic part and not these guys? It's literally the only criticism I have of this guitar. I said it to Tony Gotts, who's the CEO of Maybach. I was like, man, you know what? Like, I have one criticism of this guitar, and it's that the truss rod cover doesn't match the pickguard. That's it. Everything else is perfect. And the frets are too small, but that's a personal preference thing. As a guitar criticism, couldn't fault it. Anyway, I might see about getting an etched washer as well, but I quite like the Gibson style one. Anyway, so that's one way of approaching this stuff, is just to reposition things. Just take licks, put them in a different position. Now, you can do this also with scales that aren't the pentatonic scale. For example, you can do it with, maybe you could do it with some three note per string scales. So if you have a particular line that you tend to play, you can start to move that with three note per string things. You can move it with caged positions, with arpeggios. It all kind of basically adds the same deal. So for example, something that I did a while ago, we're going to get into some slightly more tricky stuff here. I will show you this as well. But a couple of weeks ago, we talked about the Nuno Betancourt arpeggio figures, which are these. This kind of business here. If you want to check that out, we have a stream on the subject. Just go to our YouTube channel and search Nuno Betancourt, and you'll find it. But I decided that I wanted to know the next version of that up to keep the same contour. So the same contour is, in this case, it's a B flat add 9 arpeggio. Don't worry about that if you don't know what that means. It doesn't really matter. It's two notes with a tap on the D string, two notes with a tap on the G string, two notes with a tap, and you guessed it, on the high E string. I decided I wanted to get the same arpeggio notes, but I wanted to play it here. Let me remember this. There it is. It's been a while. Don't know why this came to mind, because I haven't played it in years. But that's a lot of fun. It's basically the same lick. But what I'm doing there, in case you're wondering, the Nuno arpeggio in question, if we do it in an easy place, let's do an A, for example, the might be the following. It might be tap 14, pull off to 5, 9. Tap 14, pull off to 4, 9. Tap 12, pull off to 5, 9. Once again. 14, 7, 9. 14, 6, 9. 12, 5, 9. This is an A major add 9. Now, if I take the same idea and I move it up a position, what I might get is this. I might get 11, which is the C sharp, up here on 14, on the D string. 11, 14, that's our E, that's our fifth. Tap on 19, which is going to be, 19, that's going to be our A. Next position is going to be E, A, C sharp. That's going to be 9, 14, 18. There we go. On the top, up here, we have A. Don't let's say E. We have A, which is going to be 17. Pull off to 15, pull off to 9. Can I sequence them? Let's figure it out. Muscle memory's not quite kicking in yet. There it is. But you can get the gist of how you might use that as a way of repurposing one of these licks. Just find another position to play it in. The contour is exactly the same. The contour is the same. The lick is essentially the same. We're playing the same kind of notes. We haven't really changed a whole lot in terms of the harmonic content. We've just changed the contour a little bit, and lo and behold, a whole new lick, which is cool. And this could be your lick. This could be your version of the Nuno Betancourt tapping lick. For a long time, I thought it was going to be my version, but then I stopped playing it for some reason. Just kind of fell out of love with the tapping thing for a while. I felt like I was doing too much of it, and now I need to feel like I need to get back into it because I saw Nuno a little while ago and it was mint. Anyway, moving away from that, so let's take a look at another way that we might start to change some of our licks, which is by moving some of the notes. Now, this is quite a simple but quite a fun way to introduce some flavor into licks that you already know. So let's go back, for example, to our previous lick. Our previous lick, which was this one. This is our blues lick du jour. It's this. Now, what we can do here is we can start to just take some of the notes, and we could easily, probably the easiest way to do this, is just to shift those notes to the next available note within our diatonic scale. So, for example, or our pentatonic scale in this case, for example, we could take this bend, which is there. Instead of keeping that bend where it is, we could slide that bend up to the next note in our pentatonic scale, which would be here. So we can get this. That's a lot of fun. And now we have a lick that's different. It's not the same. It leads us to there. Now we have another phrase that we want to play. It doesn't just apply to the bends, but we could also move this bend up here. Or we can move it down here. Now this is keeping it within the pentatonic scale, but we don't have to do that. What we can also do is we can also start to introduce some notes that are from neighboring scales, let's say. So let's say we have this pentatonic lick and we decide we want to keep that flavor, but maybe what we want to do is we want to introduce a little bit of Dorian into the mix. Now, in case you're wondering, we have a course on this subject. I'm going to show you this very quickly. This is something that you can access if you're a member of GI Plus. That's our lesson platform down here. Let me show you the course real quick. It's only really short. This is about a minute of your time. This is Mastering Modes Part 1. It's going to start to show some of the process we're going to use for our next little lick. But just in case you're wondering, if you're going, I don't know what this means, then hey, you know, this is a course that's going to show you what we're on about. And when we come back, I'll show you how you can turn this lick into something a little bit more interesting, let's say, or a little bit more tonally interesting. But first, check this out. Modes. What are modes? How do I use them? When do I use them? Well, modes are one of the things that the pros use to add excitement and color to the guitar parts, and there is no reason why you can't use them too. Now, for some reason, people, especially certain online guitar teachers, love to make modes seem complicated and scary, but I'm here to tell you they really, really aren't. And in fact, if you know the pentatonic scale, I can show you how to play modes with just two extra notes. In this course, I'll show you how to play careless sounding guitar solos using modes without any of the mystery. You'll learn how to play musical sounding solos all across the neck in any key, crucially without sounding like you're just running up and down scales. So, if you're ready to take this next step with me, click the link to find out more. So that's a look at Mastering Modes Part 1. That's our course, our first course rather, on all things modes. It's kind of an introduction to playing using modes for pentatonic players. Great comment from Transparent. So scales are only a guideline, of course. It's okay to try things out different ways to make your own fingerprint. Totally agree. Now, the thing with this is you might think of the scales just as... you might think about it as a hand in Scrabble, if anybody's ever played Scrabble before. I don't know if that's just a UK thing or if it's something that other people do as well. Or any of these word puzzle games where you get a selection of letters, but it's up to you to make the words, if that makes sense. So scales are a little like that. There are a selection of options, and within those options, they'll have a certain flavor. It's also like a shortcut, it's like a recipe, let's say. It's perhaps another way of putting it. So if you're making spaghetti bolognese, let's say, spaghetti bolognese, you can tell I'm hungry, can't you? Spaghetti bolognese, you're probably going to need spaghetti. You're probably going to need some tomatoes. You'll need some kind of mince or maybe some kind of meat substitute, whatever. You will need the herbs and spices that you want to put into that particular recipe. You can put them in the proportions that you want to, but ultimately, you know, you don't get spaghetti bolognese by adding tuna or adding... I don't know, rice or something like that. It's the recipe is the guide, and stray too far from the recipe, you end up in a different recipe. It starts being something else. And that's not a bad thing. That something else might be great, but it means it's not the thing that we're necessarily going for. So think about scales more as a shortcut, a shorthand for, you know, insert these notes, get this flavor, if that makes sense. So let's talk about it. Now let's talk about how we might use some of our modal knowledge to influence our scale playing. So for example, Oh, to influence our licks, rather. I don't know why it's a scale playing, but influence our licks. Let's go to these cameras. Let's go like this. Here's a lick from before. Now, a very obvious way to play with this is to play with all of the same notes, but just change one of them. Change one of them to being a very super, super Dorian note. So what we might get is we might look for a very, very Dorian note, and the very Dorian note we might look for might be the sixth. Now, a sixth, if we're playing minor pentatonic, is going to be here. Once again. So if we try to reject that into what we're playing here, we might get this. Now that is me taking this bend and replacing it with this note as our last note. Now that sounds cool, but it doesn't have exactly the same flavor because we're not bending to it. And it also is lower than the other note we're getting to. But what if we tried to bend to this note from a different place? Well, if we're bending here, there's a few ways we can get it. We can get it by bending up a semitone. We get it by bending up a tone. We can get it by bending up a tone and a half. They're all going to have different flavors. So what we might do here is we might take this and just explore all of the options. That's very cool. Let me show you what's going on there. There we play. Blues bend is before. 8, 8, 8. And here I'm going to play 9, which is the flat 6, as a passing tone to get to our raised 6, which is Dorian. Lot of fun. What if we do it instead of playing here? You get the bend from here. You might get this. Ah. Quite as cool, but it's something interesting. What if instead of playing here or here, we drop down to our flat 5 and bend that up to our Dorian note? Well, that's interesting. Now it has almost the Lydian dominant kind of flavor to it. So let me throw these on. I'll show you what they all sound like with our track. Here's the lick. Here's the lick with a step down. Here it is bending up a semitone. Bending up a tone. Here it is bending up from the flat 5. That's pretty wild, I like that. Now, that has a bit of this Lydian dominant about it because we hear that flat 5 almost like a Chris Brown with the observations. Nice, sounds like a C minor to D7 chord change. For sure, I hear it a little bit like a C dominant to D dominant. I guess you'd call it the CeeLo Green, Forget You. Is that deal, which it upsets me greatly that the melody never follows those great chord changes. We never get this note in the melody. I can see why, it's not super pop, but it upsets me it doesn't do that. But even still, it's a way of sneaking that in, and it has that sound. I didn't go looking for that sound, but it has that sound. And it's a way of sneaking that into this chord progression without really violating the rules, because it's just the blues scale with a bit of Dorian appended. Let's do another. Let's go looking for the second, perhaps. So this is another fun way of doing it. So our second might be here, or the 9 if you prefer. Already, that sounds pretty cool. Now, our 9 is going to be the 10th fret. Confusingly, not the 9th fret, the 10th fret. On our high E string. very fun if you slide in from a semitone below. But what if we find a way to reduce this? Well, we only have one place that we're playing on the high E string, and it's this. Could we play the 9 there? Sure could. Already that lick sounds so much cooler just by hitting the 9. So what do we get? We get this. What if we combine that with our bend to the 6? That's loads of fun. What if we displace this bend? What if we play it in a different position? Loads of fun. And now we have all these different phrases. Not all of them are brilliant, but a lot of them are pretty cool. We have all these different phrases just by asking one important question, which is, I guess, is the master point with all of this. The one important question is, genuinely, is what if I do this? Now, this is a question guitar players don't ask themselves enough, I don't think, which is the, what if I did that? What if? And just trying it. Because ultimately, here's the deal, right? We're making music here, right? Unless you're John Petrucci and you're able to kill people with a shred, nobody dies from playing a bad note. Wars don't break out from playing bad notes. All the bad things that happen in the world, none of them have come from a bad note, right? I don't think, right? Anyway, unless I'm prepared to be mistaken on this, but I don't think it's happened. Ultimately, you play a bad note, you laugh it off, you go, eh, whatever. Unless you're Nick Jonas and then you suffer, you know, immeasurable career damage. But let's be honest, he had it coming. So examples of this. So let's say, okay, so here's another example of what if. This is more of a sounds what if than a playing what if, but clean sound. I'm tracking up some guitars recently, right? And I have this really cool riff that's kind of heavy. I can't play it in this tuning because it's, well, I probably could. Let's go down to C. Where's my C? There. So the riff is, I didn't write this, my friend John wrote this, but I like it. So I have some lines that I'll throw on top. Where did I play it? That little guy there to imply, hey, it's not Phrygian dominant, it's mixed leading flat six, thank you very much. Even though we all expect Phrygian dominant, even though that's Phrygian dominant, now it's not. Anyway, I'm tracking this up and I'm thinking about the sounds I might use. And in a moment of like, even though it's not metal track, in a moment of like, I wonder what if, I thought, what if I throw on a Boss HM2 that I happen to have lying around in a drawer somewhere, right? Sounds like this. That is a tremendous sound that I would never have thought to play with if I hadn't have asked myself the question, what if? I'm about to do it again. Let's ask the question, what if? Turn the slap back off, because that's probably clouding things a little bit. Let's go back to here. Not a metal zone, says transparent. It's not a metal zone, it's an HM2, which is a different pedal. It's the precursor to the metal zone, but it doesn't sound like metal zone. But what if I take the metal zone, not the metal zone, the HM2, what if I then feed it with, I have a Dan Electro Green Ringer clone down here, which is, if you've ever been familiar with an octave fuzz, so like it's an Octavia, let's say, an octave fuzz, but without the fuzz, just the octave. My favorite sounds, right? And I'll throw that on top of all sorts of stuff. But what if I take the HM2, throw the octave on top of it. Turn the tone control off. Sounds absolutely bizarre and thoroughly wonderful, but to be honest, the reason I came across that pedal in the first place is I said, hey, what if I could have my normal lead tone that I really like, my normal lead tone that I really like, and be able to throw on an octave on top without having to reach for a fuzz. Well, here's my lead tone. And I want the octave from an octave fuzz. I don't want like a clean octave, like an OC2 or anything, or a POG. I want an octave fuzz, but I don't want fuzz. I just want the octave bit. Cool as out that. Now, again, I asked myself the question, what if? What if I do this? I'm going to encourage you to make this year, dear friends, the year that you ask, what if? What if I do this? What if I do this? What if I do this? Being unafraid to explore this stuff is what leads you to being a more creative and ultimately more fulfilled guitar player, I think. So you're free to reject this, but this is what I think. And I think the more you start to ask, hey, what if I do this? And don't be afraid for it to be bad. Don't be afraid to not like something. If something's bad, just laugh. Like, whoa, not doing that again. And remember, then you'll know. You'll have eliminated the possibility. But the more you ask what if, I guess the more you'll start to lead yourself down these interesting routes. So there you go, guys. That's been a look at how you might evoke some new licks for the new year. We've got a bit of time left, so let's answer some questions. If you've got any questions, drop them down below. Any last-minute questions for the day, let me know. Let's go to the Q&A, which requires us to engage the Q&A banner. Hey, little after the click, apparently, because there's a delay, but that's fine. So, some things that we highlighted up here. First of all, Mark Crandall says, is it okay to throw in the blue note once in a while, referring to the flat five? Certainly is. I don't see why it wouldn't be. Now, this is in the context, when this question was asked, this is in the context of me saying, don't step too far out when you have an audience that isn't prepared for it. Doesn't mean the audience is bad. It just means, you know, don't step too far out and stay too far out. But that doesn't mean you shouldn't step out and do things that they aren't expecting. It just means that you maybe shouldn't live there too much. Whereas if you have a guitar audience, you can afford to really push the boundary. So you have a prog audience, let's say, or a jazz audience. But an example of the blue note in context might be something like this. Let's not do the, screw it. Let's do the octave. Why not? Be a little careful with how we deploy this, but you know, if you aren't totally overt with it and you're not doing it all the time in a way that's kind of disgusting, yeah, you definitely get away with it. But also, I once saw Buddy Guy, not in the flesh, it was a video of Buddy Guy jamming with some blues luminaries, and Buddy Guy decided that the way he was going to troll the other guitar players on the stage was by doing a solo that was almost entirely the flat five. So if we find a blues backing track, do I have one? I should organize these a little better, really. I don't want to do a slow blues, so I want to get through this a little quicker, because it was a shuffle. Let's see, where are my blues shuffles? I've got the White Snake shuffle, that's probably not what we want. I don't think I have any of my blues shuffles loaded up, which is kind of annoying. I would have thought for a second... Well, okay, there we go, right? Shuffle in E. This one's a bit cheesy, but I kind of like it because it's cheesy. But anyway, he decided he was going to play the flat five as the entire solo, and then just resolved it really well, and it all made sense. So we got something like this. Absolute horror. It was a ballsy move, let's say, and it's definitely not as cool when I do it as it is when Buddy Guy did it, because it was Buddy Guy, and I'm not Buddy Guy, but you get the gist, right? So it's a cool thing, I think. We're going to the cool question here, which is interesting, and it's a little, I guess a little egotistical of me to answer this, but it's nice of you to ask. So Marcin is asking, what are your goals this year, Nick? Well, Marcin, thanks for asking, first of all. So first things first, I am going to be releasing two albums this year. Not one, but two. One of them, the reason for that is that the release date got pushed back because of bureaucracy. But the other one is that I'm just finishing it as we speak. So we got one album to come out, two albums to come out. The goal is to play in more places that I haven't played. So go to more countries that I haven't gone to, play there. I would like to produce a lot more. I love doing these streams and keep doing these streams, but I'd like to let's level them up a little bit, you know, maybe get some graphics and fancy stuff like that. Who knows? But I'd also like to produce some more short form content that's fun and educational. So I'm doing all these videos for Victory, which is really cool. We're going to continue doing that. I'd like to do some stuff maybe just kind of on my own, or maybe, who knows, we'll figure that out. So yeah, maybe be a bit more active on social media, I guess, but primarily it's going to be to release those albums. Got some strength and conditioning related goals as well. They're probably not that interesting, but to be honest, neither are the other ones, but even still. Chris Brown is asking, solo albums, not solo albums, both band albums, let's say. I will do a solo album at some point, I think, but these are both band efforts, two different bands though. And I will say no more than that. But here's another one. Helmet Strap is saying, with the cliche lick, can you give us any tips on how to bring that up to a faster speed and be repetitive? Certainly can. So I think what we're referring to here is these Freebird style licks, where I'm not going to play Freebird, but these cool licks where I'm discovering all the blue shuffles now. There's loads of them. I just managed to miss them. They're all in my big project file over there. But anyway, let's go back to our cliche lick. So the cliche lick might be something like this. Now, some tips for bringing this up to speed. First of all, is I would encourage you to explore different technical approaches with this. And by different technical approaches, what I mean is I would encourage you to explore combinations of picking, fingers on the right hand, and hammer-ons and pull-offs, I would say, right? Because there's going to be a way that you will feel comfortable doing this that may be different to the way other people do it. You've all seen the Joe Bonamassa interview recently with Rick Beato, where he talks about where the picking thing came from, and he said the reason I got so good at picking is because I have zero legato game, and that surprised me, but that's kind of one of those things where I'm like, interesting. Here's a really cool line here from Daryl Queen. Says, we used to call those smear licks. I have no idea why. So I don't know why either, but it's cool. It's a fun lick. And I'm kind of getting back into them, even though I played like a load of that stuff when I was very young. And it was one of the first ways that I discovered how to get kind of quick. I'm convinced the little bend in this finger is not actually a basketball injury, and it's just because I play this lick so much. Probably isn't. But even still, it's definitely a basketball injury. I remember getting the ball on the tip of the finger. It sucked. I was in school. It wasn't much fun. And I wasn't even very good at basketball. I was just tall. So anyway, and then people got tall as well. And suddenly I was neither good nor tall. So out with you. If only there was powerlifting in school. Probably wouldn't have enjoyed that either. That came to that later in life. Anyway, so what I might encourage you to do is to explore whether you feel more comfortable picking every note. So I will say right away, this is not what I'm comfortable doing, but something like this. Can't do that for love nor money. That's a different lick, but we'll get to that. That's with some more hammer-ons and pull-offs. Here is with fingers. That feels way more comfortable for me, but it might not be more comfortable to you. So find a variation with this that works best and feels most natural. And what I will say is if you try them, even at slower speeds, you'll probably find the one that feels most natural to begin with at a slower speed is probably the one that's gonna work when you speed up. Now, ultimately, you only need one way of doing this. You don't need to have all the ways of doing it because really, who cares? As long as you can play those notes and have them sound cool, who really cares if you're picking every note or you're picking some of the notes? Did the notes come out? Did it have the vibe you want? And if the answer is yes, rock on. The guitar police aren't going to come and get you. I used to think this. I used to think if I hammered on too much and didn't pick enough, that guitar players with more experience than me would laugh and they'd scoff at me and go, "Oh, you're not a real guitar player because you're not picking all the notes." And then I realized, you know what? If someone's going to say that, I don't care about their opinion. But also, I can't tell. I've got pretty good ears. I can't see that stuff without slowing it down and going, "What on earth are you doing there?" So don't worry about that. Also, here's another thing. We're going to get a little deep into this. So another thing with this is don't be afraid to have an irregular rhythm with this. Now, you don't have to make every note here the same length. What I mean by this is it's not like a lick like this, for example. Let's get that white back in. Bit of a hand sync moment in the middle there. A lick where we're trying to make every note the same. Trying to be our best metronomic Paul Gilbert. We're not trying to achieve that here. We're trying to get this kind of bluesy swagger in our playing. And what this means is we can normally afford to slow down the bends, spend a bit longer over those, and actually use that as a little rest, a little bit of a rest from the speed. And then, move more quickly through the notes that you're able to move more quickly through, and then slow down the others. So if you slow down here, you put some fast notes in there. Notice how that sounds pretty fast. It sounds like it has the vibe that we want, but it doesn't, it's not all the same speed. There's only one bit of it that's really fast, which is that. One last tip with this, I guess, is one I've literally just thought of. Try using different fingers for different strings. Don't feel like you have to play. The more fingers you can get involved, more fingers you can get involved, the easier it's going to be because no one finger has to work quite as hard as any of the others. Sacred Godslayer says, these are the licks that I found harder to play for one reason or another. I totally agree. Same for me, right? It was the same for me. I found these licks really bizarrely, crushingly hard for some reason. Here's a really cool one from Transparent, who's coming in with all of the good stuff tonight. Really glad to have you on board, let me tell you. Hope you're coming back on Monday, because I love these observations. They're great. Says, I heard Glenn Tipton played exactly that in a Priest concert for 1 minute. I can believe there's a Blitzkrieg song that starts with me doing this. Where's my phaser pedal? And trying to hype the crowd up, but also trying not to die. It's just those notes. And so on and so forth, right? And that's really cool. So yeah, I have to do that with the band. And it's fun. It's a cool lick. I first learned this from copying the solo to Mr. Crowley, for sure, right? Now that's a lick that is an example of what happens when you play that stuff metronomically. It can sound really cool. I don't think it sounds like blues guitar anymore in Mr. Crowley. I think it has its own sound, which is the Randy Rhoads thing, where he kind of lives more in that kind of, it's like proto-neoclassical, if that makes sense. So it's neoclassical before it became neoclassical, but when Randy played the blues, it never really sounded like blues. I don't know if it was the tone or the touch. It sounded beautiful and cool, and it was its own thing, and I really liked that. And I think part of it is the metronomic approach to playing, but also with a little bit of scrap in the execution that I like. It's a cool thing. It's a great sound. We love a bit of Randy Rhoads. So anyway, guys, we've run clean out of time. Once again, I've run over. Of course I have. You know how these things work. So listen, I want to thank you for joining me. This is the last stream that we're doing this year, which isn't on a Monday. So from here on forth, we are on Mondays. Mark it in your diary. Mondays, 8 p.m. UK time. We'll be back this Monday, the 8th, with another free live guitar lesson. But in the meantime, I'm going to bid you adieu. My name is Nick Jennison for Guitar Interactive. I'm going to encourage you to continue asking that question, what if I do this? And in the meantime, I'm going to see what happens if I do a bunch of stuff over this backing track one more time. Thanks for having me. My name is Nick Jennison for Guitar Interactive Magazine, GI+. I'll see you on Monday, 8th of January, 8 p.m. UK time, for more good stuff. See you then. Bye for now. My name's Nick Jennison, and it's a pleasure to introduce to you GI Plus, the brand new lesson platform brought to you by Guitar Interactive. We've assembled a team of the best players and educators in the world to bring you exclusive lessons covering everything from metal to blues to fusion and everything in between. Want to level up your shred chops? Check out How to Play Fast by Andy James. Or how about Sweet Picking with Rick Graham? Maybe country's more your bag. Well, how about a full-length exclusive country guitar course from Andy Wood? Interested in learning how to play over changes? Well, members get access to hours of exclusive lessons from fusion maestro Tom Quayle. Maybe you want your playing to sound more soulful. Well, who better than Chris Buck to show you how it's done? Or perhaps you want to learn the secrets of the masters. Well, members get access to over 60 feature-length tech sessions where our tutors painstakingly decode the styles of players like David Gilmour, Eddie Van Halen, John Petrucci, Larry Carlton, Tosin Abasi, Paul Gilbert, and many more. You get all this along with exclusive live webinars, free backing tracks, competitions, and so much more. So what are you waiting for? Sign up for GI Plus today.